Hi, this is Siddharth Aluwalia. I'm with Priya Krishnan today, founder of KLAY Preschools. Hi Priya, welcome to the podcast.
Hi Siddharth, thank you for having me here.
Priya, would you like to tell us more about yourself, your journey?
Sure. So, I call myself a reluctant entrepreneur. So, I had a fairly long corporate stint. I am an engineer from Bombay University. And then I did, the fact that I say Bombay itself gives away my vintage. So, and then I did an MBA and did a consulting stint. Worked with a startup in the early 2000s and then went on to work with a company called Emphasis, which is an IT services company. I worked with them in New York and then headed up their European business before quitting to start up KLAY. KLAY as an idea came about when I did my second MBA at London Business School, and that was what triggered the entrepreneurial bug in me. There was a little bit of the pull, which was the entrepreneurial bug, but then the push was also the fact that Emphasis got sold to EDS, EDS got sold to HP, and then I said, you know, is there an opportunity now for me to get out and start this? There was also a clear demonstrated business need, because I saw a lot of the teams that I worked with in India struggling to get back to work once they had children, because they'd migrated to these cities, and I felt it was a good time to try and see if there was a product or a service that we could start up which made a difference in these women's lives.
So Priya, what time do you sleep and what time do you wake up?
I usually sleep for about 11 and I get up by about 5. I have two boys, so both Sanjay and I, my husband and I, are very hands-on with them. So from making their dabbas to sorting them out for school is something that we've always kept ourselves completely engaged in. So we get up at 5, we spend a little bit of time away ourselves, sort the boys out, and once they're out, then I get in to work for about 8:30.
So what are those moments which you spend with yourself, maybe, you know, reading or meditating, or any practices which you follow for getting more peace in your daily routine?
Couple of things. One is the fact that I've always gone to bed reading, so and I think it's a good habit I've inculcated in the boys as well. I at least spend an hour reading before I go into bed, and it could be a range of books, and at any given point in time I think I read 4 or 5 books, so you know that sort of calms you down and also helps you wind down before you get into bed. The other thing that I've become more disciplined about is about spending at least an hour exercising every day. You know, given travel schedule, the sort of toll, just mental toll, I think, you know, young business takes on you, it's very critical to find the time to stay healthy. So, you know, whether it's running or it's yoga, I seem to still enjoy individual sports, maybe because it is my time alone. But I definitely try and find between 45 minutes to an hour every day to do it.
So just summarizing, what daily habits you follow that, you know, make you very grounded as an entrepreneur?
One, I think family for me is first. And that's my personal thing, right? So the place where I find the most sanity is being anchored at home. The second is health. And the third is reading. And the fourth very important one in my head is traveling. Which again, I think unless you're going out, exploring new cultures, seeing new places, you know, you don't grow as a person. So this journey of trying to discover yourself and discover new things which you can learn from is really critical for me.
How many KLAY preschools do you have right now? And what challenges did you face while opening the first 10 preschools?
I can go through this podcast talking about this. But we have 130 now with about 7,500 students. When I started the first one, you know, you make a whole bunch of assumptions in terms of who is the customer, who's going to pick you, why do they need the service. And a lot of that gets debunked in the first 2-3 preschools. So when we started up, my assumption that it was for returning Indians or expats who lived in the city. Even though I had seen the need sitting overseas for you know, people who needed the care, my assumption was people look for either their parents or home help. Don't look for a credible child care. But what we saw was, you know, when people saw that there was a credible option, they were very willing to test it out. So that was factor number one. Second was, you know, we said if you have to provide high quality, how do we make sure that we provide all of that at a price point that's acceptable? there I think we've seen parents in India have this ability and willingness, because I think as a generation we've been emancipated by education, so they see education as an investment. So parents are willing to go above and beyond what, you know, traditionally you would expect them to do to make sure that their child is in a safe, secure learning environment. And the third biggest lesson for us was that in India, education is seen as dignified, but care is not. So care is seen as the help's job. Somebody else does it. But the fact that so many women quit to look after their children, it is still not seen as a dignified profession. So I think our biggest challenge has been to say, how do we bring dignity to that labor force? How do we say it is a really important role? How are you part of a larger cause? How are you supporting that family? How are you an extension of that family? And that's taken us a long time.
So at what point did you realize that business has got validation or the business has reached the product market fit?
I think very early on. So our first center was a runaway success. If anything, it scared us, saying, you know, very quickly, the fact that we had set it up, we expanded within less than 6 months. So the uptake for it was something that was surprising. There were some myths that got debunked as we expanded as well. We went into a we actually expanded across India fairly quickly, because we said, you know, we can be a brand that grows locally, or we learn our management lessons very early on by seeing what does it take to do a cross city option. Our third center we opened in Ahmedabad. We just assumed that, you know, all cities were equal, and we said, why don't we do a tier 2 experiment? But it's a very value conscious market, and the support structure there was fairly rock solid in terms of families living with children, etc. But outside of that, the fact that this was for a migrant family who wanted credible, accountable, transparent services, that got established fairly early on within our cycle.
What were the early failures in the business and how did you learn from them?
So, three failures if you ask me. One is the fact that we didn't attach as much importance to location as we do now. So, you know, picking a spot which is easy to access, there is easy parking facilities, that it's not a one-way system, parents can get there and get out of there easily, is absolutely critical. So for all practical purposes, we are like a high street brand, a consumer brand, where people should find it easy to come and get out of. The second was the importance of marketing. You know, my assumption coming in is that a school is something that grows by word of mouth. People say good things and other people come to it. But it is a very hyper-local business. So if you're opening in a center, letting people know that you're opening in the neighborhood is very critical. So pre-marketing and post-marketing was something we didn't pay attention to, but we've done a much better job of it now. And the third was, you know, how to attract and retain high quality talent. So the dignity of labor piece that I was talking about, saying how do we systemically make sure that people come through this, and we understand that these are also working women and their challenges, and how do we provide an environment where they feel like they're supported and cared for.
What are your organizational habits that you believe are the reasons for the success of KLAY?
I don't think it's my KLAY. I believe we actually have a hashtag called MyKLAY, which everyone uses. And the fact is that we've enabled people to have their own signature into the place. And we believe that everyone within the system feels like an entrepreneur. So as we've acquired other companies, as we've hired people from different industries, we've always said there isn't a KLAY way, if you may, right? So there's no inherent method of working. It is always open for change. It is always open for input. And as a culture, we've maintained the fact that the centers or the preschools are the center of the universe. We call ourselves the back office. That's why we are in the back of, you know, literally, it's not a fancy office, because we see ourselves as the enablers of what goes on there. They're front facing. And as a brand, we'd be very foolish to say, sitting in one central office, that we can dictate how the service is delivered. People on the ground have to feel empowered and enabled to do it on a day in, day out basis.
What are the investments you are making in your team that enable them to take so much charge and go out there as an entrepreneur?
If you ask me one thing, that my learning has been, I've come from very male-oriented industries, right? Consulting male-oriented. I ran sales and the business for emphasis, and I had a fairly large number of men in the team. This is a largely women-oriented company, and I'm not being sexist when I say this, the data plays itself out, right? Women are inherently conscientious. What they need is emotional security in the place of operation. So what we do is we create a safe space for these women to work. And in turn, I have a very, very simple mantra, which is if we have happy employees, they in turn will make sure the children are happy, if the children are happy, parents are happy, and we will grow. We don't have a very complex business. So ensuring that at the unit level, every employee feels like they're safe, that they have the ability to make a difference, that their voice is heard, and they have forums to do so, is something that we work very, very hard to make happen.
What are your learnings with scale? Like, if you had to repeat the same process again the last 7 years, what do you think, you know, could happen in a much shorter time with much efficiency?
I think I'd make different mistakes. I don't think you can move away from that. Yes, the learnings would be the fact that, you know, you should be just picking real estate appropriately, the marketing lessons. Can we fill? It's a very high fixed cost business. So we have rentals, which is a fixed cost, people's salaries, which are fixed costs. So the sooner you fill the centers, the more chances of viability of that center are. So if you ask me, you know, the fact that we should focus on saying how do we get the initial 6 months right so that the center hits profitability and we don't have to worry about that, and then we can focus on the softer aspect, that's something I would have definitely changed. And this location strategy was something I think we learned 3 years in. And ever since we've not, you know, and touch wood, we've had 130 centers, we've shut 2 in the history of the company. And that's a very, very good track record. But we've been a lot more, you know, conscientious about saying where do we put the money, how do we make sure that each one of these is successful. And the one thing that we will stay true to, you know, people ask me what is the mission of the company and what is the vision of the company. Yes, you can say I want to reach I want to enable 100,000 women to get back to work or 1 million women to get back to work. But for each one of those mothers, their child is their most prized asset. So unless we focus at that micro level, whether it's an employee or the child, and make the same difference to that child day in and day out, and inculcating that culture is the tougher piece. So for us, you know, if we're focused on saying how do we ensure the culture is preserved, we learned those early lessons, extracted them, played them back, and we did that in good time. But in retrospect, maybe just codifying it and ensuring it percolated as we grew would have been something that would change as well.
So when you are expanding to a new city or a new, let's say, overseas, have you been able to reduce the time?
Oh, dramatically. We've learned our lessons in terms of saying that what is our success formula. Like I said, you know, nobody tells you that schools have to fill in a certain place. You just assume that they do it at a certain clip. But can you fast cycle? And if you fast cycle it, what happens? What challenges do you have? Of course, if you have more children in the center, you have more set of training requirements. You have to have better staff. You have to have stronger ability to deal with, you know, issues at the center, etc. But those are ones that we can address. But today, you know, from where we would have taken 24 to 30 months to fill out a center, we probably do that in less than 18 now. It's also a bit of the brand effect, right? The fact that you're doing it consistently over locations, people trust you. But by the same measure, focusing on it brings a degree of efficiency. And we've learned those lessons. We've also not made the assumption that every market is the same. So trying to understand what works in that market, what are the gaps, messaging it appropriately. But, you know, having 60% of the formula consistent is something that we've done well.
So in our conversations, Priya, you came out as a founder who is very much structured on principles, revenue, profits. What goes on behind that thinking?
I think as a entrepreneur where, you know, you had about $30 million, I think when investors do this, they take a leap of faith and they say that I'm backing the entrepreneur. Yes, there is an IRR requirement. Yes, there is a, you know, payback requirement. Yes, they are doing it from a financial objective. But as an entrepreneur, I think you have a fiduciary responsibility to deliver to that. If you've sold a plan, it is your responsibility to make sure you see that plan through. And I don't know whether it comes from the fact that I'm a woman, but a degree of transparency and saying what works and what doesn't, and level setting and saying, hey, these are the setbacks in the market and how do we re-engineer the plan but keep the larger objective in place, is something that, you know, has stood us in good stead with investors as well. I've heard a lot of entrepreneurs saying, oh, but investors, they just are, you know, breathing down your neck and the business plan is aggressive, etc. But I also think investors don't want to operate the business. As long as they get the confidence that you're operating the business and at the principles that they have committed in turn to their, you know, partners, etc., that becomes a smoother relationship. And you spend less time managing your investors and more time managing the business.
What would be your lessons which you would like to pass on to other young entrepreneurs for fundraising, dealing with investors, working with them?
So one is, you know, in terms of saying, when you're raising money, don't sell a story. Don't sell a story that they want to hear. Sell a story that you believe in. Because if you believe in it, chances are you'll deliver to it. And if there are doubts and niggling things, you know, as an entrepreneur, I don't think any investor is expecting you to have all the answers. You're not the panacea to the problem. You're a product evangelist. And your belief in the product has to be core. The second is, you know, when you're going about to raise money, it is very critical that you have a plan that is exciting and scalable. I think what a lot of entrepreneurs get stuck in, the fact that it's my product and I know there is a need. But, you know, also convincing the investor that there is a need outside of what you believe is the need, that there is market research around it, there is some primary, there's some secondary research that you've done. And third is, I think a lot of people just assume that there is a investor-entrepreneur fit that, you know, will happen. But for it is your product and you have to know what skills you're looking for from the PE fund as well. So when we worked with Kaizen, we wanted an education fund. Because we said we're a new education company. How do we get resources from them? And then the second fund that we raised was from People Capital, which is a consumer fund. And we said, now, you know, this has become a consumption business. And so what does it take to scale? What are the lessons from, you know, cost of fitting out? What are the lessons in terms of locations? And what can we leverage out of the fund as well? So when you're going out, don't assume that they're giving you the money. Also look for what they can bring to the table. And that's very, very critical. Because as an entrepreneur, you don't have all the skills. And you want someone who can help you enable that journey.
Entrepreneurship is a very lonely journey. How do you deal with vulnerability as an entrepreneur? What face do you show to your team, to your investors, when you are vulnerable, when you are broken?
So somebody, I can't remember who, and I'm really sorry to whoever gave me this piece of advice, but one piece of advice that I feel is my pay you back in turn to young entrepreneurs is, write down the reasons why you got into it. And given it's such a lonely journey, right? You have bad days, and trust me, you have very bad days. You have days where you question, why did I give up a perfectly sane life? You know, we had a lovely home in London, perfectly well-paying job, and then you're suddenly struggling with construction workers and trying to get a project site up and going. I think revisiting that when you had a rosy hue of why you wanted to do it, always brings you up. So, you know, going back, and it's, while it sounds cheesy, writing down why I'm starting the business, what has gotten me to a point of why I want to start the business, revisiting that at the low times is very, very helpful. It's definitely helped me. The second is, you know, I come from a place where I believe your team should see you as vulnerable. It's not a terrible thing to say, I don't have the answer right now, but collectively let's figure it out. If anything, to your early team, it endears you. I to date say it, right? You know, if, to a center head, the fact that she knows the consumer a lot more. If I'm not seen as showing respect for that, and if I'm seen as the founder 7 years back with some vision for the world, you know, she is not going to feel like she can contribute to the organization. So I think vulnerability is not a terrible thing, demonstrating it, but surety as far as financials are concerned, surety as well as the fact that it's going to be a going concern, that is an individual responsibility, and that's not something you can get other people to shoulder.
So what have been your moments of self-doubt and how did you overcome them?
So, like I started this, I said I'm a reluctant entrepreneur. So my journey started with a doubt of saying, what if I fail? But Sanjay's played a very big role, my husband has. He said, you know, what is the worst that can happen? You can fail. And I was 35 when I started the business. And he said, 3 years from now, you might say this was a miserable failure. We can move back. People will hire you back. And what is the downside here? That you will get a character building lesson. And when you break it down like that, I think it helps you say, okay, so, you know, it's well worth jumping into it. The doubts have crept in, you know, in terms of saying today we're responsible for 2,100 people's salaries day in and day out. The day is, you know, we are not meeting our revenue numbers to make sure that you're responsible for that many lives, that many children. You have moments where you say, you know, how am I going to make this happen? How am I going to enable the next 10,000 women to go back to work? When you run out of money, you don't know where you're going to pay salaries from. When that funding gap comes, when a center opens, and we opened our first center, and I remember this, we opened it in a month called the Ashad month. I don't know, I'm a Hindu, but I clearly don't know my months very well. And we opened it on 18th of July. And 15th of July to 15th of August is considered an inauspicious period for anything like admissions. And people would come and they would walk in and they'd look at it and say, what a beautiful school, but nobody admitted their child. And we were like, what did we do wrong? And then, you know, on 15th of August, but those moments, you're like, what, you know, is this going to survive? Is it going to see the day of light? In some ways, I think we've crossed that threshold, and I feel as a company, now we're a going concern. We have a team that can see it through. And that 7-year journey has been it's had its trepidations and its tests.
What were the moments during these 7 years where you were just about to give up?
I wanted to bury my head in the sand, but I've never wanted to give up. Like I said, I take the responsibility of, you know, that Didi in the center and the fact that her monthly salary, and she's made some commitments for her own children's education basis this, that's a huge responsibility. So giving up on it was not an option. But wanting the problems to go away was definitely there. And then you deal with it. You break them down into bite-sized chunks. And those moments come many, many times, right? You just have to say, I'm going to bide over this, tide over it, get on, and then, you know, there'll be the next one that comes along. But that's the reality of being an entrepreneur. It's both the thrills as well as the downsides.
As an entrepreneur, I also myself face, you know, many moments of depression, right? And I dealt with it, you know, by meditation or by reading or by talking to other entrepreneurs. How did you deal with these moments of depression? And I think 7 years, any entrepreneur would face them many times.
Many. I can write a book on those low moments. But I'm anchored, like I said, with my family. So the place where I find, where people find meditation as a release, for me, time spent with my children helps me diffuse the situation. So sitting and listening to their stories, and 20 minutes. There'd be a day where I traveled for 2 weeks in a row. I will tell the team I want to work from home, because spending time with them during the course of the day re-energizes me and I'm back with a bang. So while I've not gone to meditation, I feel like that's my meditation, my time with the kids.
How do you define success for yourself? And how do you define success for KLAY as a business?
So success for me is, you know, actually the plan for KLAY came from an obituary column, which was, you know, I wanted to be known as a good mother, a good wife, a good daughter. And I wanted to leave a mark in the world. And I feel, you know, with every child we've had in the system, we've made a difference. So for me, the 7,500 going to 10,000 going to 100,000, doing it consistently day in and day out and making that experience seamless for each parent as we scale is what I would define as success for the organization. My own personal success comes from the fact that I'm able to balance work and home and find personal time for myself. So there are three parts that are conflicting, and, you know, trying to make sure that I'm able to balance those three, that I'm seen as a supportive wife to a, you know, entrepreneur husband. Two boys of 14 and 10, that, you know, they see life and take the life lessons, and that I'm able to pass those on to them. You know, where I have children in my centers, I'm not outsourcing my parenting journey to my own parents or to someone else.
What are the three books you would love to recommend to any young entrepreneur?
So Founder's Mentality is one book which we're also trying to implement as in the organization. Again, as we've scaled, one of the things in the book is based on research and is a very easy read, but it talks about how do you inculcate the founder's mentality into the front line. The second, and these are not necessarily, books that are, I have such a long list. Can I give you all of those? But there are, so some books are fiction books, some are autobiographies. I was very inspired by Steve Jobs' autobiography, not the personal side of him, but the fact that he had this creative side to him. And if you ask me what is the takeaway, it is to say that how do you create a team of A players, right? And how do you ensure that A players are challenged because you're hiring and attracting more A players into the mix. And then there are books like Yuval Harris's book on 21 Lessons for the 21st Century. I think that's been an interesting read for me. It's a recently released book. But the context of, how the world is changing, and given we're in education, how we have to think about how these children are prepared at these formative years for what's likely to come. The change of jobs, change in technology, change of environment, and how do we adapt them to that?
So as an entrepreneur, you always have too many moving parts at any point of time. How do you get to a point of focus at any moment within yourself and within your team? How do you make them focused?
So when you have multiple moving parts, I think one person has to take charge and say, here is what I believe we need to focus on. And in our case, we've over the years honed it down to saying what the business metrics are and how do we align ourselves to the business metrics. The unknown, the known knowns are the easier ones to deal with, right? The known unknowns are also something that you can anticipate. It's the unknown curveballs that come, which might be minimum wage changes, etc. Focusing the company back onto saying that how do we focus on fill out of centers, and actually you can boil the business down to four metrics. I don't think it's very complex. It is just that bringing the simplicity and driving that simplicity through your team. So for us, it's a high cash flow business. It's a high fixed cost business. It's an EBITDA valued business. So if we don't stay focused on these three, we will fail as a team. And as every problem can be boiled into one of these parameters, and we just have to learn to react.
What advice you would like to give to any young entrepreneur who is just starting up and has an aspirational goal of making a $100 million company in the next 5 to 7 years? What would you advise him for habits? What would you advise him for discipline?
So don't set the end goal on the 100 million. There's a concept called ikigai. In fact, I was talking to my older son about it. It's a Japanese concept called ikigai, which is the confluence of four things. Your passion, which is what you love doing. Your mission, it should make a difference in the world. Your vocation, which is something that the world requires in terms of skills and you're able to contribute, and your profession, so something that pays you. If you can make the four meet, that's your perfect dream venture. Setting a goal which is, big, hairy, audacious is critical, but by the same measure, not being driven only by that, making sure that you have baby steps to get there and small measures. It's like losing weight in some ways, right? You don't say, I want to lose 10 kilos, but you also should celebrate the every 500 grams, 2 kilos that you lose, because that makes the journey a lot more enjoyable. And if you're really, truly passionate about something, in retrospect, the only thing I would tell people is jump straight in. The only downside is failure, and it's not a terrible thing. Right? So those are some of the best lessons you can learn by failing, not by succeeding. So,
thank you so much, Priya. It's been great interacting with you, and I believe our listeners will learn tons of wisdom from your journey.
Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity, and I wish you tons of luck as you go along.
Thank you.